Today's topic is, a very delicate, sensitive, difficult issue. As I will talk, the joint study of history between Japan and China was over at the end of 2009, and the report was published in January 2010. And I talked much about those processes and report in 2010 or so. But I have not talked too much after that for a year or so. But because, the tensions between Japan and China, Japan and Korea are resurging. So that's why I have to, I began to think that I have to talk about this topic. Let me start with pointing out that the history issues are rising and becoming more intense recently. Don't you think it's strange a little bit? Because now the most of the people in Japan were born and raised after the war, and while the tragedy took place before the war mainly. And technically that today's Japanese people are not in a position to take responsibility for the issue. Still, the tensions are becoming intense, and atmospheres are becoming harsher in recent time. For example, in the recent time, the textbook issue took place first in 1982. So it's already after 37 years after the war, and then also other issues are becoming to be talked much more after the end of Cold War. There is an institution by the name of Salzburg Seminar in Salzburg in Austria. If you have seen a movie of Sound of Music, you may remember a beautiful castle by the name of Schloss Leopoldskron Castle, in which you could see a pond or small lake on which Maria and the children played over the water, and then by mistake they fell into the water. You may remember that place. And in that Schloss Castle, there is an institution by the name of Salzburg Seminar. One of the major programs of Salzburg Seminar is historical justice and reconciliation. That means there are many issues all over the world over these historical issues and reconciliation. Why? I have one answer. There are, of course, many reasons why those history issues are becoming more and more important today. First of all, the diplomacy, the focus of diplomacy used to be war and peace. How to bring peace? That's a major issue for the diplomats. But after 1945, there have been no war between among the major powers. So all the countries have committed to solve the conflicts by peaceful means at the United Nations. So the wars, of course, there are exceptions like the Korean War, Vietnam War, many other wars. But basically, among major powers, there has been fewer wars. And then economic issues became more important than the issues related to war and peace. But also, the conflicts over economic issues were to be solved in WTO after mid-1990s. That's partly why we are playing more with the issues with images, and it boils down to the issue of identity, who you are, who I am. That could become the most important target of diplomacy. And unfortunately, this issue cannot be solved easily. So the answer is a very difficult one, on which I'll talk at the end of this seminar. Anyhow, Let me start with remembering my experience in Japan-Korea Joint Study of History, which was started in 2002 and was over in 2005. I have no PowerPoint on this. So this PowerPoint is only for the process of a Japan-China Joint Study of History. So that my outline covers, of course, all, but I will go to show PowerPoint in some part of my explanation when I come to the joint history of between Japan and China. I just proposed to establish a dialogue between Japan and Korea on historical issues. Of course, there have been many dialogues between the scholars between Japan and Korea on many issues, but one most critical issue had been avoided. That's the Japan-Korea relationship. That was most sensitive, difficult issue, so the scholars had deliberately avoided to touch upon that. But I thought that it was high time to discuss this issue between the scholars of two countries, and I proposed it when I was a member of the Prime Minister Koizumi Junichiro's Task Force on Foreign Relations. And it was adopted and it was established. It had some device we created. We just thought about the structure, and we created some supporting committee within the cabinet office, in which we had some director general from Ministry of Foreign Affairs, who was Tanaka Hitoshi, very famous diplomat, and also the counterpart in Ministry of Education, again, a director general from Ministry of Education, and myself, the specialist on Japan, and also now Professor Emeritus, then Professor at Keio University, Okonogi Masao, who are the very specialist on Korean issues in Japan. Those four just got together and consisted the supporting committee. And then we just tried to have some contact with the government, and also the supporting committee was to support the scholars committee, which was led by Professor Taichiro Mitani, who was a mentor of me, and I tried to persuade him to be the leader, because he's a very well respected, widely respected scholar, and then accepted it after much hesitation and reluctance. He came to see some bureaucrat, government official, to decline. But when he was about to leave home, his wife said that, but this is a very important job. Then he accepted it. So you know how important the influence of the wives. So that's why I just try to organize this kind of system. This is because, you know, if we organize the dialogue between the scholars only, that will not have any impact on the education through the ministries of education, because particularly in Korea, the education was in the hands of the Ministry of Education, particularly the textbooks, the national textbooks. Let me also say from a different angle, there have been some dialogues between the scholars, you know, the scholars between Japan and China, Japan and Korea. But that can be sometimes very ineffective or sometimes dangerous. For example, Japanese scholars who are very left-wing scholars invite the scholars from Korea, then they can discuss in a very comfortable manner. The result would never be accepted by the Japanese people. The opposite can be done. For example, the right-wing Japanese scholars inviting right-wing scholar or the scholars who are anti-regime and then to Japan, and they may make a very comfortable discussion. But that argument could never be accepted in Japan, in China, or in Korea. So some connection with the government policy is needed. That's why I tried to create this kind of device. But this is again very difficult one. They actually after I just went out from this dialogue when I was appointed to the ambassador to the United Nations, but I was there for 2.5 years, or almost 3 years. And then our leader, Professor Mitani, became cancer. According to him, it is because of this activity. And also his counterpart also became cancer. Of course, I think this is accidental. I don't think this is, I have been safe so far, okay. We just try to select the topics very carefully because, you know, at the very beginning, the atmosphere is very difficult. We intended to have a very calm, quiet, scholarly discussion. It was very difficult to do in Korea. When we tried to have a first meeting, many activists ran into the meeting the meeting place, and then the atmosphere is so noisy. And then when we hired an interpreter from Korea who turned out to be an activist, who just gave the information to the to outside people. So the maintenance of the quiet atmosphere is not easy. But anyhow, we did it. And then we tried to select a very topics very carefully. One topic was, for example, the development of department stores in Korean Peninsula. This is an academically very interesting topic. How the consumer life was developed in Korean Peninsula. Of course, it can be politicized. From Korean viewpoint, they could say that, oh, those department stores are only for the Japanese people in colonial Korea, vice versa. And also we tried to write a paper on Japanese army, Imperial Army in Korean Peninsula, the role of Korean army, which is a more political issue. But anyhow, we tried to pick up a very special topics. And then it was anyhow over. But as a result, we thought that this was a rather successful one, but it did not have much impact at all, because mainly because the topics are too special. The department stuff, who cares about the development of department stores in Korean Peninsula? And in other words, we try to avoid most difficult issues like Takeshima or comfort women, because I thought this was the first effort to tackle on this issue. But eventually we could have a common feeling among the scholars between those two teams that actually this was remarked by two leaders, that we scholars have to become breakwater against the rise of nationalism. So this is a sense of emerging sense of responsibility as scholars against the rise of too much dangerous nationalism. Okay, this is something I remember on the Japan-Korea Joint Study of History. So this is just for the reference, and then let me move to the Japan-China Joint Study of History. Well, I was a member of the Japan-China Friendship Commission for the 21st century, which was established by Prime Minister Nakasone in the 1980s and Hu Banyo from China. And then this was considered to be the top dialogue, top level dialogue between Japan and China. I was a member of that dialogue in the latter half of the 1990s. The history issue was always discussed in there. And then there was one difference between us. Of course, there are many differences, but anyhow, one difference was